Roberto made blackened fish very famous in the 80s, and I loved it so much. It was a wonderful New Orleans dish that I decided to come up with my own version. So I have three rules about it. Find the thinnest fish you can, start with the hottest pan, and preferably use a cast iron pan. But let's start by talking about the fish. Now, when I first came up with this recipe, I used sole. And the reason I liked it is it's so thin. And there's some sole that you can find that's sustainable, but not all is. So I've switched to something that's nationally sustainable, which is tilapia. Now, the problem with tilapia is half of it is very thin, but the other half of it is quite thick. So here's my solution. I freeze it. I've got some here that I froze for about 20 minutes. And then it's easy to cut the fat part in half. The reason we freeze it, anytime you freeze any protein, it firms up. And it's just firm enough that you can cut it easily without hurting yourself. Here, I'll just show you one of these guys because I've already got some done. So you get down at the level of the fish so that you can see exactly where you are. I can see that I'm about a half inch in. And you just be very careful and take your time. And then you see you end up with two pieces that are a lot thinner. And the reason I like the fish to be thin, because it's all about the crust. You want a lot of crust in relation to the fish. So the thicker pieces you cut in half, and the thinner pieces of the tilapia, remember I said there's two parts, you just put them in straight up. Okay, now that I've got my fish ready to go, I'm actually gonna soak it in milk. Why milk? Milk is a deodorizer. Even fish that's not all that fishy becomes less fishy when you soak it in milk. Okay, so I've got some that I've soaked. You do it for at least a half an hour, and you can do it longer than that, even up to a whole day. There we go. Here's some I've been soaking. So that is ready to go in just a minute, and I'm gonna meanwhile get started on my side dish, which is grated zucchini. I love using the grating disc of my food processor. It just does such fast work on grating things. And also, if you can grate it quickly like this and not on the coarse side of a four-sided grater, you save your fingers. Okay, for years I thought zucchini was the most boring vegetable on the planet. What makes it boring is all the water in it. So we want to lose the water. Guess what? Underneath all that water, zucchini has the most wonderful, intense, sweet zucchini flavor. So I'm going to topple this into a colander here, and we're going to add some salt. It only takes about 15 minutes to drain. Look at how beautifully that's been grated. If I did that by hand, I would be grating for the next 20 minutes. Let me just get a little salt. We're going to add about a teaspoon and a half. And it's amazing how quickly this goes down in volume after you toss it with the salt. Let me show you now, this is gonna sound so like, oh yawn, I've done that. How to slice an onion. And when I say how to slice an onion, there's several ways you could slice it, but there's only one correct way. You could slice the onion this way, or you could slice the onion following the ribs. It literally shows you what to do. Years ago, I was lucky enough to be working with Julia Child. For a while there, I couldn't work with her and we needed a replacement. And I brought in a friend of mine who was actually a very accomplished chef. And let me get my heat on, actually. And Julia was sort of testing her out and testing everybody out to see, you know, what she thought of them. Here goes some oil, olive oil, extra virgin. And my friend didn't slice the onion the way I am. She sliced it crosswise. Based on that, Julia didn't hire her. Ooh, this is the right way. I'm not quite sure why. You're wondering why? It just makes sense and gets you, I guess, the best pieces. I'm gonna get this in the pan. Let me crank this up a bit. We're gonna get some color on these guys and a pinch of salt. It's a good idea to season as you go. All right, time to make our famous blackened spice mix. So we're gonna start with a tablespoon each. This is hot paprika and garlic powder. And it's a great mixture to make and have in-house. And then we need a teaspoon and a half of oregano, thyme, cayenne, onion powder, and black pepper. Okay, so a teaspoon and a half of the thyme, of the cayenne. This is spicy. And you notice how bright red that cayenne is? That indicates to me that it's very fresh. Spices lose their color as they get older. Black pepper, freshly ground. Sort of looks like a kindergarten art class, huh? With all these colors. And that is it. I'm gonna just mix this up. And that's all that's involved. Oh, you know, I think there's a little bit of salt goes in there too. Here we go. Mix it up well so you don't get all cayenne in one bite. Okay, 3 tablespoons. And this will keep for several months. You want to keep all your spices in a cool, dark place. And they certainly don't go bad, they just get less strong. To this spice mix, I am going to add 3/4 cup of all-purpose flour. Now, the reason I have this set up this way is because I like to use the parchment paper to toss the fish around. Good old all-purpose. About another teaspoon of salt. And we're using kosher salt. It's coarse, it's easy to measure. That tastes awfully good, just even like that. All right, my onions are getting somewhere. And I need to get the rest of the ingredients ready for my zucchini. I'm gonna go squeeze my zucchini. So look at all of that liquid. Wow, and that's not all. There's even more that's gonna come out. I'm gonna squeeze it right into the sink. And what we're doing is concentrating the flavor of the zucchini. Look at that. Whoa! Okay, now let me show you what we ended up with. You remember what we started with. Now, isn't that ridiculous how much it squeezes down? It's like, it's so sad, but don't worry. It's so tasty, it's worth it. So in this goes with our onions. Let's dump it in. And it really, at this point, only takes a few minutes. So it gives us just enough time to cook our fish. So I'm gonna start flouring my fish. And let me just say that when you flour your fish, you wanna do it the last minute. I generally end up flouring myself too, but this is a good trick I learned in restaurants. And then I'll get my oil in the pan, and I'm using vegetable oil, and then right after that, in goes my fish. You don't need a ton, particularly if your cast iron skillet is well seasoned. Okay, here we go. It's not making a lot of noise, but it is smoking, so I know we're okay. All right. So while that cooks on the first side, I am going to go add the seasonings to my zucchini. There goes our lemon rind. And thyme is very nice with zucchini. The juice, we know we don't need any salt. And then you just need to taste it and make sure it's the way you like it. And see, it keeps its nice green color. Okay, back to here. Now, when you want to flip the fish, get all the oil to the end of the pan where you are not. All right, so the way you know it's done is you take the thin tip of a knife and you go down. I know this is gonna be done because it's so thin. And if it goes through with no resistance, then you know it's done. This, oh, actually, that's pretty good. Okay, I think we're ready to take them all out. Let me just put a couple pieces on here. All right. Let me get this off the heat. And let me serve up the rest of our dishes here. Our beautiful zucchini, wonderfully hot. Really, my kids didn't used to like zucchini when they were little, and after I did this, they completely got on board. Smashed potatoes, a few lemon wedges. So you see how easy that was? I mean, that took less than 15 minutes. So, wow, I'm gonna go have a yummy dinner. Wow, that looks so delicious.
Like New Orleans, Charleston, South Carolina is known for its take on traditional Southern cuisine. But that style of cooking owes a huge debt to enslaved cooks and farmers. They were captured from West Africa and taken to South Carolina because they had valuable skills.
You call them Carolina Gold. That was the name of the rice, Carolina Gold. Charleston built up off of rice money, the sweat of the ancestors' back.
Storyteller Carolyn Jaboulet White's ancestors were slaves who settled on isolated coastal islands. The Gullahs, as they're called, had their own language.
But back in the days when I was a little girl, Madam would catch a chicken and wring him by neck, because we had what you call the yard chicken. Yard in Gullah means the yard.
a group on that, the yard chicken. Mm-hmm. And whatever was left, the gravy and whatever was left, my mother would make this rice.
Charlotte Jenkins is a legendary Gullah cook. Her rice is based on a style of eating she remembers from growing up Gullah on the South Carolina coast.
The one thing that I love about it is that you had everything at hand. We had a farm. We planted, all our vegetables. We had chickens. We had pigs. They would go out fishing and crabbing and oyster.
The most important thing about Gullah food, I would think, is that it be fresh.
Fresh ingredients, that's the basic, because you cannot make a good shrimp dish with Indonesia shrimp.
Fresh food was abundant here by the sea. Steps away from Charlotte's house, I went crabbing with her nephew, Tori, and Gullah chef, BJ Dennis.
So, this is Gullah country?
This is Gullah country, Sea Island culture.
Okay, and it goes for how far?
It goes from Wilmington, North Carolina to Jacksonville, Florida. But the low country of South Carolina is the heart and soul of Gullah Geechee culture.
Wow.
And food ways.
And that's where we are.
That's where you are right now.
Okay, so. And this is where you used to go and get crabs?
Yeah, you can go get crabs out here. My friend Tori is actually out here right now.
Oh.
Bringing his crab pot back in.
So you would just come out and forage?
I mean, that's how the culture was, lived off the land and off the sea. So crab, fish, oysters, everything was self-sufficient. That was a way of life.
Oh, wow, yeah, you got beautiful. Some guys there.
You got some fatties in there.
Yeah, this is pretty good.
Wow, I mean, that's a good haul. I mean, of course, I'm not an expert. What do I know about crabbing? It looks good to me.
And he got some rusty ones too, which means they're nice and fat.
Right. Oh, really?
Yeah.
That color?
That, yeah.
You always want them straight out of the water.
Mm-hmm.
And
lively. Like these guys.
Right.
So you're gonna rush right home and cook these?
Oh yeah, fresher the better.
Yeah.
This land right here,
yeah.
People farm, they fish, they shrimp. A lot of it comes from West Africa, where you lived off the land. It was a very agricultural place.
In fact, many crops originally from Africa, like watermelon, sesame seeds, and peanuts, became American favorites. They found their way to Southern cooking through African-American cooks. Chef Joe Randall runs a Southern cooking school in Savannah and says ingredients like okra came over with the slaves.
I can't imagine any other way for them to get here. They were on the ship, maybe to feed the slaves. They brought what they could to feed them. The slaves were in the kitchen doing the cooking, and they were familiar with the okra. Okra is a dish very prominent here in the South, primarily because it was a dish that was brought from Africa to the South.
Even barbecue was developed in the slave kitchen.
The slaves were restricted on the things they could eat. The master saved the pork loins for the pork chops for himself, but a pork shoulder might get left for them, and so they would smoke it low and slow. That method of slow roasting was done in Africa. It's similar to the way the Hawaiians use hot rocks and dig a hole and bury a whole hog.
So much of Southern and Low Country food traces back to African American traditions. BJ Dennis thinks it's not well understood.
We've gotten away from a lot of the traditional values of how we came up. The way my grandfather and his grandparents ate is kind of different than what we see now. So it debunks the whole myth of Southern food being fried and greasy. And when you're raised in it, you really don't realize it until you step outside. And then you come back and say, wow, we do have a very, very special, unique culture.
If you're a fan of the foods of New Orleans, boy, do I have a treat for you today. I have a native, grew up there, my good friend, Aris Johnson, And that's not all. Besides the fact that you're a thorita on Cajun food, correct?
Yes.
Yes. She also has an incredible history. She's worked at all these fancy restaurants in New York, including for some real screamer male chefs. And she survived. She's also a two-time winner, well, first place and then second place on Chopped, which is pretty amazing.
Yes.
So what are we making?
Today we're making jambalaya.
Oh, yes.
Jambalaya is a rice dish with origins in West Africa, and it has influences of Italy and France. And these are all the cultures that came together to make Cajun and Creole cuisine in New Orleans.
Okay, and what's in it?
We get started with the base, mm-hmm. which is the base of all our dishes in New Orleans, and it's called the Holy Trinity.
Oh, yeah.
Onions, celery, and green peppers.
The Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
And then we always have a special guest star that's not part of the Trinity, which is the Pope, garlic.
Oh, dear.
Would you mind chopping the celery?
Just small dice?
Yeah, small dice.
Okay.
So I'm gonna add the celery mm-hmm. next, and this is all flavor building by adding these vegetables one at a time. Not gonna cook the celery as long as we did with sweating the onions, because we wanna keep it kind of crisp. This is actually pretty quick, like compared to some of our other dishes, like gumbo.
Oh, that roux cooking for
yes.
hours
yes.
and hours. I wouldn't have the patience.
Like the time that it takes to make the roux for gumbo, we'll be finished with the jambalaya.
Okay, got it.
All right, so I'm gonna add the green pepper.
All right.
And just let that saute for just a second. And we're gonna add the Pope.
Okay, yes. Here comes, I feel, well, whatever. It's what it's called.
Yeah, gonna add the Pope,
there
very important.
Pope. Okay. And that was, okay, so that was one onion,
yes.
one green pepper, three celery ribs,
yep.
and four cloves of garlic.
Yes.
Okay.
Could you grab the andouille sausage
Absolutely.
For me?
Yeah. And what do we have, about a pound there?
Yes, about a pound. Andouille sausage is a sausage made with pork shoulder and it's fat and it's smoked. It's a meatier sausage than most sausages like kielbasa. It's more of like, more robust. All right, let's go right into the pan.
This slides right in, huh?
Yep, yeah, I'm gonna adjust.
Look at that, that's perfect.
Beautiful, right? And just the smell, like the smell of the Trinity and the Pope together.
Oh my God.
That's the smell,
happy smell.
Of my childhood.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So next, I'm gonna add chicken. So we're gonna season it with a little Cajun blend. This is like the basis of your basic Cajun seasoning with a few special guest stars, right?
Okay, I like that.
Yeah. So we have some paprika. We have some cayenne pepper. We always want to have a little heat, just a kick to remind you you're alive. Some garlic powder, onion powder, black pepper, and salt.
Okay.
So I'm just going to season our chicken thighs.
And what do we have? We have about a pound there?
Yes, about a pound of chicken thighs.
And how much seasoning?
I like to season with my soul, you know. And I'm just going to saute this in a separate pan.
Okay.
So I'm gonna add a little grapeseed oil.
Mm-hmm. All right, I have to ask you the million-dollar question. What is the difference between Cajun and Creole?
That's a very good question. So the big difference between Cajun and Creole is one, Creole has the addition of tomatoes and seafood, and Cajun is from the land. So it's made with meat and things that walk the ground, walk the earth. So we have our chicken nice and brown.
Okay.
Gonna leave that there for a minute. And so now we're gonna continue to build our flavors in our pan. So we're gonna add some crushed tomatoes.
Okay.
So when you see jambalaya.
Should I stir?
Yes, please.
Okay, I gotta be useful somehow, huh?
Yes. Definitely stir.
Okay, we just went over into Creole land here.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so we're also gonna add some chicken stock. So I added one can of crushed tomato and about a quarter chicken stock.
Boy, this has everything in it.
Yeah,
this
it
is
does.
A one pot meal.
It is. So we're just gonna season this and we wanna make sure we season this really well because this is our flavor. After the rice is cooked, you usually don't season it again, so.
Right. And also because rice can absorb after the fact.
Exactly.
It has to go in
exactly.
to seasoned. People don't know that, so.
Yeah, so we're gonna add the chicken.
Yeah.
With the fat and everything.
Oh, of course.
We want all of that.
We want all that flavor. Fat is flavor.
Yes, yes. So we have some fresh thyme and bay leaf, not off the stems, just right in. Let's talk about the main event.
Yes.
The rice, because this is a rice dish.
Right.
Have about 2 cups of parboiled rice here. With parboiled rice, it's a guarantee that you'll get nice separate grains of rice every time. And outside of that, parboiled rice actually has like some good nutritional value because there are nutrients added into the rice that helps it cook the way it does.
Oh no.
Time for the lid.
And then how many minutes?
20 minutes, but right before the 20 minute mark, we're actually gonna add some shrimp.
Oh, okay. Here we go.
The shrimp gets seasoned just with simple salt and pepper.
Okay.
So we'll add scallions maybe when we plate it up.
You want me to slice them for you?
Yeah, slice them. I think it's ready for the shrimp. Let's see.
Oh, wow.
Ooh, it's looking good. I'm just gonna give it a
look. Look at how it absorbed all that liquid. I'm always amazed,
yes,
you know?
Yes,
there's so many miracles in cooking.
Right?
Don't you think?
Exactly. We're just gonna give it a little fluff, but the other thing we're doing too is like kind of releasing some steam, mm-hmm. and that steam is gonna help cook the shrimp. So you can go ahead and
plop it in.
Yep, just plop it in.
Plop away.
And I'll use a spoon and kind of spread it out.
Okay.
Evenly.
Okay, so how many more minutes?
About 5 more minutes, just until the shrimp is cooked through.
Okay. Oh my God.
Woo-wee. Good.
Gorgeous.
I think this is ready. The shrimp looking nicely cooked. So let's just add those scallion whites. Adds a little brightness since it's fresh. So I'm actually gonna add some hot sauce.
Okay.
Just for a little extra kick of flavor. And not too much, but at the same time, don't be shy.
Yeah, I'm never shy when it comes to hot sauce.
All right.
So.
All right. So you like a lot or you like a little?
Oh, of course I want a lot.
All right.
Are you kidding? I like sausage too. I like it all. It's all good. All right, a little garni.
Yes.
All right, okay. Let's go dine al fresco. I'm gonna bring the hot sauce.
Yes, don't forget the hot sauce.
The moment has come.
I know.
Too exciting. Oh, geez.
Let's get into it.
Yes. Wow. Mm. Oh, I'm pretty speechless. You know, that seasoning is really the key. Yeah. This is deeply seasoned, and I don't mean salty.
Yeah. No, just flavorful, flavorful.
Yeah,
yeah, that's a big, big misconception. You know, that we get in Louisiana a lot, that the food is spicy.
Mm-hmm.
It's not spicy, it's just very flavorful.
I'm gonna say this and you're gonna think I'm joking, but I'm not. This is the best jambalaya I've ever had.
Oh, thank you.
Not that I've eaten a ton. My God, this is so deeply flavored.
Thank you, thank you.
Well, I have to say, it's been such a pleasure. I mean, it would've been good enough if I just got to eat this, but to learn how to make it with you, although now I really need to know your secret spice mix and every last thing in it.
Oh, I'll tell you.
But in the meantime, thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Today on Sarah's Weeknight Meals, we're taking a munchies tour of the globe, starting at the world capital of snacks for dinner, Spain, home of tapas and some very fancy ham.
How much does it cost?
Approximately 1,000.
For how much?
For 1 kilo.
Wow, that's like $500 a pound.
My host, Chama Vidal, showed me 2 easy tapas, the famous small bites of Spain.
It's very, very simple.
First, a potato omelet you'll flip for.
Four.
Oh, wow.
And it doesn't get any simpler than this local favorite, tomato and bread.
That's it?
Back in my kitchen, we'll go to the Alsatian region of France for a caramelized onion pie.
There's only 3 ingredients in this hors d'oeuvre. It is onion, bacon, and cheese.
Then on Ask Sarah, one of our viewers is drowning in spices.
It's bad.
Kathy, you are out of control. That's quite clear. We have to do a little intervention here.
Did someone say spices? Snacking my way across the globe, I got a crash course in Turkish cheeses at Istanbul's famous Spice Bazaar.
It's sheep's milk cheese preserved in goat skin.
Wow.
Then a Turkish TV chef used one of those cheeses in a dip to cheer for.
Yes. Okay.
Exhausted? Me too. And here's the perfect solution. Have a snack for dinner. Today on Sarah's Weeknight Meals. Tourists might come to Catalonia, Spain for Barcelona's mind-bending architecture or the drama of the Costa Brava. But if you're like me, you come for the food. Three of the top 10 restaurants in the world are here. And even home cooks like Jaume Vidal take pride in Catalonia's fine food and fresh ingredients.
What a beautiful garden. I'm so impressed. And what are we getting now?
Now the peace.
Jaume lives in the fairy tale village of Madremanya, where we sat down for a very Spanish snack of wine and jamón.
So, you've got some of your own wine here. You make your own wine.
Yes.
Oh, well, you've got to tell me about it. So, it's special, huh?
Yes, this is a wine, my wine. It's the vintage 2011. It's made with 60% Merlot, 40% Carignan.
Now, I've heard of Merlot, but Carignan is from here?
From here, from all Spain, made Carignan and Tempranillo.
Tempranillo.
It's a very, very old grapes.
Those are the two main grapes?
Yes, two.
Wow, but this area in particular is good for this kind of wine?
Yes, because the field need these
the
grapes.
Soil.
The soil need these grapes. When you taste, you have a violet color, have a red color, very, very, very intense. And when you taste.
Oh, it smells wonderful.
You
wow.
That
is
fruit.
Delicious. That is delicious.
Thank you.
Yikes.
Thank you.
Okay, now the perfect thing to have it with, I understand, is ham.
Yeah, for this wine, these red wines, it's very important with the meat.
Okay.
And dry meat or cooked meat.
Here in Spain, cured meats reign supreme, and none is more important than jamón. The preserved ham proudly displayed in any bar or restaurant. We tasted the less salty Catalonian version.
That looks sort of like prosciutto.
Serrano ham from the mountains. And the king of them all.
And this is Iberic pork.
Oh, Iberico.
Yeah, this is Iberico. It's the pork of the black porks live in the fields. And it's very, very expensive, this ham.
How much does it cost?
Approximately 1,000.
For how much?
For 1 kilo.
Whoa, that's like $500 a pound. Yikes, for us. And what makes it so special?
It's special because she lives free in the fields.
Oh, they run free, okay.
Yes, and she eat only...
Acorns. I remember that.
Yes.
They're from oak trees. Well, I think this wine is going to be just perfect with our
tea. It's perfect with that. Mm. Salud.
Yes.
Our next tapa is a Spanish classic, tortilla española, a potato omelet made with eggs from Jaume's farm.
Everybody in Spain loves tapas, and we're making one of the most popular today. It's called tortilla española. But I want to start with, what have you been doing with the onions?
So I put the onions with oil.
Olive oil, of course.
Then I cook it just to brown it. But I add wine.
You add wine?
Yes, and water. Different times I cook just tender.
Oh, till it's now, very tender.
Yes, very, very tender. I think 5 minutes more.
Okay. Well, you're going to cut up the potatoes. Go ahead. And tell me, tell me about the tortilla española.
The tortilla española, every region has your... system to...
Has their own version.
Yes.
So depending on where you are.
For example, I made the tortilla española with boiled potatoes.
Okay, and I should say tortilla española is actually sort of an omelet with a lot of potatoes in it. So it's eggs and potatoes and onions.
Yes.
Yes.
It's very, very simple. Now we have boiling water with salt.
So you've got boiling salted water.
Yes. Now cook it 5 minutes approximately. 5 minutes.
5 minutes?
Yes.
Okay.
It's cooked.
Okay. Should we make the other tapa, the tomato bread, while we're waiting?
It's pan tomata.
Pan tomata.
Yes.
Okay.
I have a very big bread.
Oh, bring it on over here.
Aquí.
Oh, that's beautiful, that bread.
It's made with an oven, wooden, with fire.
Oh, you mean a wood-burning oven. That's what we call it. Okay.
Okay.
All right.
And now I cook the bread. Mm-hmm. Normally, this bread is possible to make pan tomata and toasted or not toasted.
Okay.
I like it not toasted.
Okay, and then I understand you have a very special kind of tomato.
Yes, this tomato.
Oh, show me. So this is a totally different kind of tomato.
This tomato?
Wow.
Is the tomata de penjar.
Which means?
Holden tomato.
Hold on tomato?
Yes.
Because it's holding on for dear life, is that it?
Because this tomato, it's
plucked,
yes,
or harvested. Yeah.
In August, September, uh-huh. And just the next year, it's possible to eat this tomato.
So these are fresh tomatoes,
yes,
but they don't go bad and they keep for months. Wow.
I put here. How? And then I put in the bread.
Oh, you just rub it on?
Yes.
That's it?
It's very, very easy. That.
That is easy.
And it's very, very good.
Okay.
Then I take salt, mm-hmm. A little salt. Olive
oil. I don't think we've had enough today. Wow.
And I cut.
That's it?
Pan tomata. It's okay.
Okay.
Test.
Should I taste it?
Yeah.
Oh, I can't wait. Wow. Oh my God. Mmm. That was so good.
It's very, very simple. But it's very weak with tapas.
Wow, I gotta have another bite. Do you think our potatoes are ready?
Yes.
So here are your beautiful eggs.
Yes. That here.
Okay. Is that good? All right, so.
I need another pan.
Okay. Oh, is that because this is your omelet pan?
Yes.
For eggs, so it doesn't stick?
Only for eggs.
Only for eggs?
Omelets and eggs.
Okay.
If you like, put the...
Just put the eggs in?
Yes, inside.
Okay. Again, put those... Oh, look at that yolk. Wow.
Oil?
Oil?
It's very yellow.
It is very yellow. Okay.
Now... I added potatoes.
Oh, wow, you don't even beat up the eggs first.
No, I beat when all is inside. Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't matter that the potatoes are hot? They will not cook the eggs?
No, because it's very, very quickly. And salt.
Is that good?
That's, I think it's correct. The pan is very, very hot.
Jama has a unique way of cooking the omelet evenly.
Turn.
Oh, wow.
See?
Uh-huh.
And.
Amazing. So pretty. And how do you know when it's ready?
Well, if it's dry inside.
Okay. Oh. That's beautiful. That is beautiful. We'll make it perfect. Wow. Wow! Voila!
The ancient Catalonian town of Madremanya is pretty spectacular. The view, the food, the wisteria. Could there be a more beautiful place to enjoy our all tapas meal?
It's very good.
The Spanish say, eat a big breakfast, a light lunch, and a lighter dinner, and you will live a long life. As long as I can have these delicious tapas for dinner, I'll live forever.
Salud.
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 So, you know, I have to ask you, do you really sit here with me? This next dish is really going to impress you. I had it the first time several years ago when I was on a French riverboat cruise, and the chef happened to be a German chef. And he made it one night, it's sunset, to go with some wine. I was so blown away because there's only three ingredients in this hors d'oeuvre. It is onion, bacon, and cheese, served on a very thin crust. So I've got about 6 ounces of bacon here that I'm cutting into quarter-inch slices. I've got a medium-low pan preheated, and I'm gonna add them to the pan and cook them till they're just barely golden. Everything in this recipe is ultimately gonna go into a 500-degree oven, so we wanna make sure not to slightly undercook it, because it's gonna brown in that oven later on. I'm gonna transfer this bacon, now that it's perfect, to paper towels to drain a bit. I'm just gonna let them drain. Now I'm gonna pour off all but 2 tablespoons of the bacon fat. Okay, let me get the onions in. Here we go. 4 cups of onions, and you want them paper thin. Now you are gonna be absolutely astonished when we are done about how far they go down. We're gonna cook these onions covered for about 10 minutes. Time for the topping. Let me start with my egg. I just want the yolk. Okay, that's gonna go in there, boom. Let me just break it up a tiny bit. It's amazing how simple this recipe is. We're using a whole 8 ounces of creme fraiche. Use creme fraiche. Don't use sour cream, don't use yogurt. I'll tell you why. Neither one of those items, dairy items, has a high enough butter fat content to hold up in a 500-degree oven. And now we're gonna add a little bit of nutmeg. A little bit of salt and pepper. And that is it for this topping. Now, everything I'm making is good for 3 pizzas. We're just gonna make one because it's snacks. Let me check my onions. Oh yes, those look wonderful. They're translucent, meaning they look clear. And I'm just gonna keep cooking them on medium low, for about another 20, 30 minutes. We're looking for a golden color. And if you don't cook them low and slow, you aren't gonna get that flavor. Okay, so while these are getting brown, I'm gonna go over and look at a book. You know, I think those onions are ready because they got very quiet. Whenever you're cooking, you should use all your senses, and one of them is sound. Look at those, my God. That is absolutely perfect. Next, for the pizza dough, I'm gonna do this trick that I learned from my Sicilian makeup lady many years ago. Oil the board, oil the rolling pin, and that way the dough will stick to the board and you won't have to chase it around as you do when you do it with flour. You can either make your own pizza dough or you can buy store-bought. So you'll need about 1/2 pound per pizza. I want this pizza to be about 1/8 inch thick and vaguely a rectangle. The shape really doesn't matter. So one last round, and then I'm gonna transfer it to parchment, and then we're gonna need to roll it out again because it's gonna shrink as I transfer it. So then I'm gonna roll it out again. All right, I'm gonna move this over and top it. I'm gonna spread about a third of this creme fraiche mixture. Next, we're gonna put on one third of our gorgeous caramelized onions. Let's get our onions down here, the star of the show. So I'm gonna just sort of drop this as I can. Isn't that beautiful? It's like, it looks like golden hair. All those thin strands. You just wanna make sure that every bite has some onion in it. Just like anytime I eat, I want everything to be in that bite that I have. I'm gonna spread about a third of the bacon. I've got 4 ounces of Gruyere cheese. I've preheated my oven to 500 degrees, which takes about a half an hour. We're gonna pop this in the oven. Oh yes, oh my goodness, wow. I'm gonna check one thing that's very important, how the crust looks underneath. Let me see, yep, looks nice and brown. Now, I'm gonna cut it. Oh, wonderful crispy crust. Oh, fun times, yes. Of course, I would love this with a really lovely chilled wine, but I could see this with beer. And that was really pretty simple. Don't you think this would be the most delicious snack for dinner? Woof, my Alsatian onion pie. A segment we call Ask Sarah gives me an opportunity to answer your questions, which I really love doing. So today we have a wonderful person, Kathy Rowe from Fayetteville, New York. Kathy, I understand you have quite a spice collection. What's your question?
I do. I have a lot of spices. I have big ones, bags, some that aren't labeled. I'm not even sure what's going on anymore, in jars. So my question to you is, what is the shelf like? Where should I store them? Basically, and how long can I keep them for?
Well, Kathy, you are out of control. That's quite clear. We have to do a little intervention here. I've got quite a few tips that will help you, but let's start with how you buy them. Buy less, buy smaller amounts, both so you go through them more quickly, but also those large jars tend to be sort of stale to begin with. They're just too large. Dried spices will keep for a year. Whole spices will keep for 2 years. Now, it's not like they're gonna kill you after that. You're not gonna keel over, but you're just gonna need to use more. Ground versus whole. Ground spices are great in a pinch, but if you have the option, like cumin, which you can get both whole and ground, there's a few things you can do to make it even more exciting if you have the time, and you sound like a serious cook. So this one's for you. Here I've got some cumin that I put in a dry pan, no oil, and I just toasted it over, say medium heat, until the color changed and it started to smell. And even better is to then grind it up. So then you grind it up in a spice grinder and you won't believe, oh, it really, it's so aromatic, so wonderful. So now let's talk about storing. I see all your bags and you have them all over the place, right?
It's all over. It's bad.
Okay, so I would go with glass. Also, try to get the same size jars if you can. Cool, dark place. And ready for this dorky hint? And this really is going to change your life. Alphabetize them.
That's a really great idea.
It was so much fun to talk to you.
Thank you. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
And I hope you all will reach out to me via the website for Ask Sarah. And who knows, maybe you, like Kathy here, will come on and talk with me on the show.
The Istanbul Spice Bazaar is so much more than spices. It's overwhelming. Luckily, I had local food writer Aylin Onetan to show me around, starting at a Turkish cheese store.
You have to taste this. This is something very interesting. It's sheep's milk cheese preserved in goat skin. It has a very satisfying mouthfeel. It's tangy, but it's still buttery and creamy. So it's very satisfying, I find.
Wow. Mmm, that's amazing. That looks like butter.
This is the quintessential Turkish cheese in, in every table. This is beyaz peynir, which means white cheese.
White cheese. That makes sense. Mmm. Wow, these are all so flavorful.
Well, it's all over the Balkans. The Greek feta is the same. The Balkan white cheese is the same. So we are talking about the cheese of the Balkans. This string cheese is really...
That's a really good one.
Yeah, this is very, you have to taste it. It's very dolce, you know, very sweet compared to the other one.
Mm, I should say so.
I was happy to bring that string cheese across the river when I visited Istanbul TV chef Rafiga Birgul. We used it in an easy mushroom and cheese dip, part of a magical rooftop dinner party.
Now we're going to make a string cheese with mushrooms to dip.
Okay.
And here you can taste it.
You know, we have string cheese in the United States. Somehow I'm feeling that it's not quite the same.
It's more milky and it's very nice. It can be. I think it's.
Ours is rubbery compared to this.
I think this cheese should be as popular as mozzarella in the world.
Yeah, it should.
Yeah.
It's tangy, your version.
Yeah.
Okay. So this just goes on?
Yeah, it just directly goes on. Mm-hmm. I'm going to mix it with 10 mushrooms. Mm-hmm. I've cut them like this.
By the way, I'm going to add the thyme, a couple sprigs of thyme to this too.
Shall we do it together?
We should do it together. Wow, that is so unique. That is wow.
Thank you very much. This is garlic with a bit of salt.
Okay.
I'm going to put 3 tablespoons of olive oil. Mm-hmm. So that the taste of the garlic goes to the olive oil. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to spread it around with my hands. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to take a pepper. And I'm going to mix it with my hands.
Okay.
This looks like nothing, but you know, it's going to be adorable.
It looks like noodles.
And we are going to directly put it in the oven.
Okay. Mushrooms and cheese dip for a traditional Turkish feast. But what's a feast without friends?
Hey!
Good news, we've got that too.
Bread do we have?
Yay! Yes. Okay. Opa! This is the Sarah size.
Oh, goodness. What am I,
bigger one.
Big? What is our drink today?
This is tangerine. It's like lemonade, but with some tangerines.
Mmm, it's delicious. Yeah! Okay, what's the toast?
Şerefe!
From Istanbul to Spain and France, there's a world of snacks out there. Why not have them for dinner? Even Mom would approve. I'm Sarah Moulton. Thanks for joining me.
That's me and Julia Child in 1979, when we worked together on Julia Child and More Company. Can you believe it? She was 6'2" and I barely made it to 5 feet. Now, even though we didn't see eye to eye physically, we became great friends for 25 years.
So, in tribute, I'm making fish meuniere, the first dish Julia ate on French soil. And this is very un-Julia. I'll do it with just 5 ingredients. That's what we're aiming for today. 5-ingredient surf and turf recipes. Like the steak with homemade butter. My brother Peter approves.
When you start with a steak, this flavorful, this flavorful.
This is so good.
It's a cinch.
My salmon is oh so posh with its crispy skin and tangy Greek sauce. And hello, still only 5 ingredients. And on Ask Sarah.
I can't quite get Eggs Benedict right. So do you have any tips for poaching eggs?
You're way ahead of the game.
That's all coming up on Sarah's Weeknight Meals.
Welcome to the French Chef. I'm Julia Child.
That voice, who could forget it? But it was Julia's height that launched her career. During World War II, she tried to join the military, but they said she was too tall for the uniforms. So she joined the CIA, then called the OSS. They sent her to Sri Lanka and China, and there she met her husband, Paul, who introduced her to the pleasures of good food. But newlywed Julia couldn't cook a thing. Her true culinary epiphany came in 1948 when she and Paul moved to France.
Welcome to Sarah's Weeknight Meals. I'm just about to make the dish that changed Julia's life. It was the first thing she ate when she moved to France with Paul, and Julia ordered, not knowing what she was ordering, I guess Paul must have helped her, sole meuniere, which means literally sole in the style of the miller's wife, and where the miller's wife comes from is flour. So essentially it's fish dipped in flour, sauteed, but it was ethereal. So I'm gonna get started on this fish. We're using trout, because trout is just much more sustainable these days. I'm gonna pour some milk on here. Another trick I learned at cooking school and from Julia. Julia was French trained, as we know. After she had this iconic meal, she went on to go to the Cordon Bleu, not too long after that, because she wanted to cook the kind of food that she had eaten at this restaurant. And she learned all about French technique, and so did I. That was my training. But anyway, one of the things that we learned is to use milk as, for better way to put it, as a deodorizer. So you have something that's strong in flavor, like fish or liver or game, you soak it in milk. Milk is also a tenderizer, but you don't really need to worry about that with fish, because fish is very tender. So I'm going to park this in here. Let me just rinse my hands. And while that's soaking, I'm going to go out and get some parsley in my garden because I want some fresh herbs. Okay, now we can cook the fish. Now I want to point something out while we can see it. This is the pretty side of the fish. This is the not-so-pretty side of the fish. The not-so-pretty side is where the skin was. And the reason I bring this up is when you cook fish, you only flip it once. So you want the pretty side to be the last thing up. So you put the pretty side down when you put it in the pan. If you keep flipping the fish back and forth, it will break because fish is very delicate. It has no connective tissue. So salt and pepper. Now, Julia, in the classical way, would have been to use white pepper. White pepper for white things, black pepper for everything else with color. I don't like white pepper, so I'm sorry, Julia. I'm gonna use black. I can't help myself. Kosher salt and black pepper. So I just have to get this really, really hot. Tell you about Julia at Le Cordon Bleu. So she and Paul get to Paris and they find this cozy little apartment. Very cozy. I mean, Julia was a big person in a tiny kitchen. And she wanted to cook for Paul, so it occurred to her to enroll in the Cordon Bleu. She only had GIs in the same program, all men. And then eventually she finished the whole program and she went back to take the exam and she didn't remember the recipes. She flunked. It was awful. She was devastated. There we go. And eventually, much later, she went back, she took it, she aced it. Yay, Julia. And I'm smelling it. One of the things Julia taught me was, usually when you smell it, it's almost done, or it is done. And this is particularly true with baking. I want to cut these lemons into sections. because I'm going to add the whole sections to the sauce. So I'm going to take off the top and the bottom, and then we're going to go down either side. We're making what's called a sauce grenoise. It's a brown butter sauce, and it means in the style of Grenoble. And it involves lemons, capers, brown butter, and parsley. And fish absolutely cries out for acid, so you have to add acid. And because I am really smelling that fish, I'm gonna go back over and see how we're doing. For once, I'm gonna use a fish spatula for fish. Okay, when you flip it, you wanna tip all the oil away from where you're flipping it so that you don't end up flipping it and getting the oil back up in your face. All right, and then this one I'm gonna tip back this way. There we go. Isn't that beautiful looking? So I'm gonna turn on my green beans. I'm gonna start warming them up. So what you do is you go through the sections. I'm gonna section it, so you go through the membranes. You see the little white membrane there? You go on one side. Okay. How do you know when fish is done? When the knife goes through easily, and that went through really easily. Here it's gonna go through, it's done. And the second side never takes as long as the first side. So I'm gonna get these out. Fish cooks from the outside in. So if you like your fish medium rare, then you want a little resistance when you put the knife through. And fish, like everything else, has carryover cooking time. So take it out before you think it's done. Let me get my butter in first. I'm gonna do a couple of tablespoons. I'm sure that Julia would do more than a couple of tablespoons. But let me tell you something about Julia Child. Her motto was, everything in moderation. And she meant both of those words to be emphasized equally. So eat everything, just don't go hog wild with it. Oh, you can see the butter's getting wonderfully brown already. I'm gonna put in my lemons. I'm gonna work quickly. And some capers, here we go. Capers are the pickled bud of a Mediterranean flower. I have no idea what genius stopped one day to look at these flowers and say, I'm gonna go pickle that bud. I think that's a brilliant idea. Okay. In go the capers. Ah, this is beautiful. My beans are ready. I like this piece, I think, the first one I did. There we go. On the plate, we have some beautiful potatoes. I was trying to think of an appropriate French name to call them, maybe pomme persillade. I don't know, but they were roasted and then just tossed with a little bit of parsley. Persillade means parsley, we like parsley. Maybe I'll put a few of those on the plate. And then last but not least, spoon over my sauce grenoise. This is a very Julia dish, I'm telling you. She loved her fish. Wow, doesn't that look delicious? Trout Meunier in honor of Julia Child. Of all the hats I wear on Sarah's Weeknight Meals, this little segment here is my favorite, Ask Sarah. Today I have Nurubi Balam from Austin, Texas. Hi.
Hi, thanks so much for inviting me.
Tell us a little bit about yourself.
We rent chicken coops and backyard chickens for families here in Austin, Texas that want to enjoy fresh eggs. Because even with the freshest of eggs, I can't quite get Eggs Benedict right. So do you have any tips for poaching eggs?
The very first thing you said, which is that you have fresh eggs, you're way ahead of the game. What happens when eggs are harvested is, like us, they start to go a little flabby. That white starts to separate out into a very watery part. I've strained this to get rid of the watery part of the white because then we will have a prettier looking poached egg.
That's one of the things I didn't like when I made them, that they were watery. So that's perfect.
Yes, because the watery whites give you those spidery edges. All right, so now how to poach. So what you do is you fill up a straight-sided pan like this. I've got in here 2.5 quarts of water that I brought to a boil, and I'm adding 2.5 teaspoons of white vinegar. White vinegar helps the egg to set up. so that you get fewer of those little strands. I break my eggs into ramekins so that they're very easy to just drop into the water. I'm going to turn off the water completely and then put the lid on. And 2 to 2.5 minutes later, they'll be done.
No swirl necessary?
No swirl required. Okay, Nurubi, are you ready? Here we go for the ta-da moment. Okay, ta-da. Oh, that looks awful. I only strained the one I showed you, and the other three must have been very old eggs. So I'm going to take the very pretty one. If you want to serve it right away, you just take it out while it's still hot. Just dry it on a little napkin or, you know, side towel. And then I'm going to put it, this little guy, on top of a salad. Yikes! There we go. I hope that was helpful. I wish I'd had fresher eggs.
Thank you so much. That was super helpful.
Thank you. And for all of you there, send me your questions to the website. I would love to meet you this way and talk about your big issues in the kitchen. Every July 4th, my family has a New England tradition of cooking up whole sides of salmon, either grilled or baked, with a buttery sauce. I mean, yummy, but I'm going to take my salmon this year in a different direction. I'm going to try to replicate that crispy skin that you get in restaurants. I just love it. And I'm going to top it with a Greek sauce. And guess what? It's going to be really exciting. It's going to be really tasty.